Hello everyone! In this video, we'll have a look around GameMaker's room editor, learn about its many features, and become acquainted with this very powerful tool for game design. This tour will serve as an introduction to the layout of the room editor, where to find resources, and some basic guidance for creating your very own levels. From simple and easy, to complex and breathtaking. This video will focus on the rooms portion of the room editor, covering its respective tools and resources, and will be presented from a top-down point of view, starting at the broader concepts, then diving into the finer details. You can take a look at the playback bar or the video description for individual segments and timestamps. But I highly recommend sticking around for the whole thing, even if you're not new to GameMaker. You might pick up on things you might not have known before. One last thing before we get started. If you don't already have a project of your own to follow along, you can try one of the many templates offered by GameMaker in the startup window. In this video, we'll be using the platformer template. Level 0. Rooms. Before we can talk about specific level design tools, we have to start with the most fundamental piece when creating a room, which is creating the room itself. In GameMaker, the environments of games are usually defined by rooms, screens in which gameplay elements are placed and interacted with. Rooms can serve many functions, from fully playable levels to UIs and menus, and even templates for procedurally generated content. For the scope of this video, we are going to focus on linear gameplay levels, but the skill set is much the same for all other applications. Creating a room. Making a room is very easy. Go to your asset browser, look for the folder that says Rooms, and right-click it, then Create Room. And that's it! If you wish to rename it, you can right-click the newly created room in the Rooms folder, then click Rename. Alternatively, press F2 with the room already selected. If you also wish to organize your rooms better, you can separate them into subfolders by right-clicking the Rooms folder, then clicking Create Group. You can click and drag rooms around to reorder them, or move them inside folders. Room Inspector Properties. After creating a room, you might want to adjust it to better fit with your specific game, or with other rooms. For that, we head over to the Inspector tab, on the left side of the room editor on the default layout. If you're not seeing it, don't worry. All you have to do is click again on your room over on the Assets tab to highlight it. Let's go over each setting for a room and what they do. Room Settings. Here we see four settings: Persistent, Clear Display Buffer, Width, and Height, and two buttons, Creation Code and Instance Creation Order. Let's start on Width and Height. They set the full size of your room. There are a couple things worth keeping in mind, however. First, the size of your room is not necessarily connected to the size of your screen. You can have a room that is bigger than what your player can see, thanks to different sized cameras, something we'll talk about in the next section. And second, the size of your room does not dictate the boundaries of game elements. You can still have them placed out of its bounds and have them move in and out of its area at runtime. Persistent here means that, during runtime, the state of objects in this room will be preserved if your player goes to a different room and comes back later. This is very useful for things like hubs, options menus, or special gameplay areas that players can pass through multiple times. However, it's important to keep in mind that this comes at the cost of added memory usage, and so should be used only when necessary. Clear Display Buffer is an option that tells the engine whether or not it should clear the screen before drawing each subsequent frame. This doesn't have a significant impact on most cases, and is only relevant if your room's viewports, something we'll see later, leave empty gaps on your game screen. For the scope of this video, we'll keep that box checked. Moving on to the buttons now, we first have Creation Code. It gives you an interface to write an optional piece of code that gets executed once immediately after your room is initialized. It is useful for things like defining room-specific variables, calling functions, making checks and tests on global variables, or any other thing you might want to do when the player enters that room but before they start actually playing in it. Lastly, Instance Creation Order opens a window where you can define the order in which the objects in your room get instantiated. For example, you might want the player to be the first thing that spawns, followed by enemies, in case the enemy's code needs an existing player in the room for it to work. Click and hold to drag instances through the list. Viewports and cameras. Like I mentioned earlier, the size of a room doesn't have to be the same as the area visible to the player during runtime. That is, in fact, the job of viewports and cameras. In GameMaker, viewports are regions that dictate what will be shown to the player in-game. You can have viewports of various sizes and resolutions, following objects, and even multiple active at once. You can enable or disable viewports by checking the Enable Viewports checkbox in the Room Inspector. If you have viewports disabled, the engine will try to fit your entire room into the window size of your game. Not always a great look. So for this video, we'll have them enabled. The next option, Clear Viewport Background, will clear the application surface with the window color before drawing each frame, and shouldn't have any visible impact if your room has any form of background, even if just a solid color. For the scope of this video, we'll keep that box checked, unless you want these trippy trailing artifacts. Scrolling down further, you'll see 8 different viewports, numbered 0 through 7. You can mark any of them as visible by clicking this checkbox. Multiple viewports can be set to visible at the same time. For now, let's start with viewport 0 and set it to visible. Here, we have 3 groups of settings: camera properties, viewport properties, and object following. Camera properties is how your game will sample the image it will display. It defines a rectangular region from within your room that will be shown on screen, much like an actual camera that you can position and zoom freely. X-pose and Y-pose set the position of the camera in relation to the top left corner of your room. Width and height define the area of what the camera can see, also known as the camera's frustum, and extends down and to the right of the position defined before. You can actually see the outline of the camera region in the room editor if you have your viewport set to visible. Viewport properties is the other side of the coin. It defines the region in which the camera's contents will be drawn on. You can think of it like the size of the screen that will play the camera's feed. You may have a camera that covers a large area, but have its image shrunken down to a tiny screen. Or even the opposite, a tiny camera image blown out to a large screen. Here, X-pose and Y-pose define the offset of the final image inside the game window, again going from the top left corner. Width and height, in turn, define the dimensions of the image in that window. Finally, object following moves the camera around such that it tracks a game object. For example, if you're making a side-scroller platformer, you might want the camera to always follow the player. Or, if you're designing a cutscene, you might want it to follow an NPC. You can select the object of your choice via this object selector. Then, we can configure horizontal border and vertical border. They specify the distance from the edge of the camera, not the viewport, to the object being followed. If set to 0, the origin point of the object will go all the way to the very edge of the camera before it starts spanning to follow it. Conversely, if you set it to half of the camera's width and height, the object will always be at the very center of your viewport. Finally, we have horizontal speed and vertical speed. They define the speed at which the camera moves in order to follow the object. If set to negative 1, the camera will instantly follow the object as soon as it starts leaving the boundaries we defined earlier. But if we set it to a number above 0, it'll pan out at that speed until it catches up with the object. Setting it to 0 just makes the camera stand still, in case you were curious. All units pertaining to positions and dimensions are in pixels. If your game is tile-based, you might want to calculate the appropriate multiple of your tile sizes in order to match your room's grid. Horizontal speed and vertical speed for object following are in pixels per frame, so you might also want to calculate how much that is in, say, seconds. Room physics. Room physics is a group of settings related to GameMaker's built-in physics engine. It is an advanced physics engine, also called the physics world, that applies to games which require realistic simulations of collisions. To enable it in a given room, press the Enable Physics checkbox. As this is a more advanced subject that doesn't apply to most projects, we won't go much in depth about it. But a quick overview of the settings is as follows. Gravity X and Gravity Y specify the pull of gravity in either axis, while pixels to meters defines the measurement units for gravity in that room. These combined settings will give you a vector for gravity, whose direction and strength is defined by the XY values divided by the pixels to meters value. Room inheritance. While creating a room, you might have noticed a sneaky button called Create Child Room. That is what's called room inheritance, when a child room inherits properties and elements from a parent room. It is ideal for situations where multiple rooms share common traits, similar room properties including viewports and cameras, similar layers, or even similar objects and tiles. We'll talk about how to make changes to existing inheritance in the next section, but to create a child room, right-click the parent room of your choice, then click Create Child Room. Some changes to a parent room will be automatically reflected in the child room, but if you make changes to the child room, you can manually update them to be in line with the parent room by selecting your child room, then pressing this Inherit button. Here, if you made changes to layers and their contents. Here, for changes made to the room settings. Here, for changes in viewports and cameras. And here, for changes in the room physics. The Inherit button is a toggle, so if you only want to update the contents of a given option, press the button twice so it stays highlighted. What this also means is that if you want to ensure some changes to the child room remain that way, you can disable room inheritance for that particular option by toggling off the Inherit button like so. This action can also be taken in individual layers, instance properties, and much more. We'll only cover room-related cases for this video. Room Manager. The rooms you create have a specific order that is taken into consideration by the engine. When using functions such as room go to next and room go to previous, as well as deciding the initial room to be loaded when running your game, GameMaker looks at the room order, which you can configure in the Room Manager. Click on the house-shaped icon to the left of your initial room, or this icon that shows up when you hover over other rooms, to open the Room Manager window. In it, we have two tabs, Room Order and Room Inheritance. Room Order is where you define the order in which the rooms of your game are navigated. Click and hold to drag rooms on the list to reorder them. Alternatively, you can use the buttons on the bottom of the window for sorting. The room at the top of the list becomes the initial room. When you run your game, this will be where you start. The Room Inheritance tab is where you manage parent and child rooms, which we've covered previously. Drag a room into another to turn the room being dragged into a child of the one you're dragging it into. Conversely, drag a child room out of its parent to make it independent again. Room Navigation. In order to manage your scene, be it with layers, tiles, or objects, it's important to understand how to navigate it. The Room Editor offers a number of ways to make navigation and editing easier for you, so let's go over them. Firstly, to pan around your scene and look around, you can press and hold the middle mouse button. Alternatively, hold down space on your keyboard, then click and drag with the left mouse button. Scrolling the mouse wheel up and down will pan the wheel up and down, but holding the Shift key will change it to pan left and right instead. Next, the zoom functions. At the top right side of your room view, you have this toolbar, and in it, the following buttons. Zoom out, reset zoom, zoom in, and center fit. To zoom in and out, you can use one of these buttons or hold Ctrl on your keyboard, then scroll the mouse wheel. You can also use Ctrl plus or Ctrl minus to zoom in and out. Ctrl Enter is the keyboard shortcut for the Reset Zoom button, both of which put your view at the same size as the game's real proportions. Finally, the Center Fit button, or Ctrl F, will put your entire scene within view and centered on your screen. Up here at the toolbar, we also have some grid settings. These settings apply for each individual layer, with the only exception being tile layers. Clicking this button or pressing G on your keyboard toggles the grid visibility in the room editor. Clicking on this little arrow to the side of it brings up the grid settings. With it, you can change the appearance of your grid by changing the grid color and grid opacity, as well as the grid size horizontally and vertically. Lastly, the Snap checkbox lets you toggle whether elements snap to the grid when being moved or placed. Disabling the grid also stops grid snapping. This square button, called Show Views, will toggle drawing the rectangles that indicate the room's viewports. This only applies to the editor and does not affect them in-game. Likewise, the Play button, called Play Animation, will toggle animations in your scene, be they animated sprites or animated tiles, on objects or scrolling backgrounds. Selecting object instances and assets in your scene is as simple as clicking them. You can move them around by clicking and dragging. Holding Ctrl lets you select multiple elements, even across separate layers. Moving them while holding Ctrl will make them stop snapping to the grid. Holding Shift, then clicking and dragging, will let you select multiple elements at once if they're within the selection region. Pressing Escape or clicking an empty spot will deselect everything. The last button on the toolbar, Select from any layer, shortcut B, lets you select multiple elements from different layers. This includes different element types at once, such as objects, assets, and sequences. You can use it in conjunction with the Shift selection mentioned earlier, or you can manually select different elements by holding Ctrl. One additional neat feature is that, when you have it enabled and then click on a tile, the editor will bring you to that tile's layer and place the corresponding tile in your tool, ready to be used. If you have multiple objects or assets selected, they show up in your Spectre window, located at the bottom left of the default layout. This lets you change their properties individually or in conjunction, without having to reselect them multiple times. Thank you for watching this video! I hope you learned something new! If you liked this video, consider leaving a like, and if you want to learn more about the Room Editor, be sure to subscribe, so you don't miss out on future video tutorials like this. Do you have any questions or tips of your own? Make sure to leave them down in the comments below. Happy game making!